and for public consumption, so that,
like, yep, no problem, mate.
Okay, great. So I just took a little brief look at what you have on the album. So, yeah, it looks good. So maybe we can use the session best for just basic design rationale, make sure I'm hitting all the points. You might have seen the initial results on the tractor, which we're going to scale up. So basically, I was loading down this base tractor module with the tracks down to like 8,000 pounds. It works well. So we're going to scale that up to like 24,000 pounds and get ready for some ripping. So it's looking quite good. Yeah.
Cool.
So I have a document. Maybe if we can just basically...
Even that small one will be a useful machine.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. That's pretty good. So yeah, I mean, we're trying to get serious about... the equipment actually working well and all that. So maybe let me show you this. Maybe we can go on this document here. So click on this link. So I just started basically a design document. But these are some of our priority requirements. So maybe we should start with the requirements, and maybe you can comment on that first. And then if we could maybe spend a little bit of time just going through some details, some critical aspects to have, like,
okay. So what have you shared? Just here in the chat. Design page, or is that me? Did I go? Oh, right, I'm in control of this. Sorry.
So if you go in, so in this document, you can actually edit that. Have you worked collaboratively on Google Docs?
Yeah. I did. I just
yeah.
I was just in a space where I thought it was a presentation, not a not a Google Doc for some reason. Anyway.
Yeah.
I had a late night last night, so I'm still waking up a bit.
Yeah.
Now what do we got? Requirements, calculations, prior art. Okay, cool. Got that.
So I'm thinking of basically a souped up plow that's modularly based around 4x4 tubing. So we can slap on the shanks and other additions
That makes perfect sense.
Mm-hmm.
Get to that in a moment when I talk about the frame. So is that the frame? The page 4?
Page 4? Yeah, I mean...
You've got a box.
Just...
Yeah, I just didn't know what it was.
Started something. Just... Yeah.
No worries.
Yep, and the first question being, it's like, is it riding on wheels or is it off, down, and up for cylinders? You know, things like that. I started drawing that up. I didn't know how to start on that. But the good thing is, around the modules, the square tubing of the tractors and all that, we can put super heavy arms. So for the bulldozer part, for the front and for the back, we can design it either like a ripper with down pressure or just a drag-along thing.
Yeah. If we've got downward pressure, it's not a bad thing. And I think if this were a design that people were taking on, which is obviously the idea, it'd probably enable both, because if it was just a drag along, then that might be a starting point where people are... I don't know the 3-point linkage design to your bulldozer, but it would obviously be cheaper to just have a typical 3-point linkage than to have a hydraulic one where you've, well, hydraulic in the sense that you can apply downward pressure.
Yeah.
The downward pressure is really, in my opinion, only required when you need when you're ripping at the wrong There's a very few occasions where you'd need it otherwise, because the angle of the point on the shank is such that as soon as it starts dragging along, it usually just starts digging, provided that the moisture is right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can have the hardest ground in the world, but if it's got a bit of moisture, then it's like a fork. You know, a fork.
Yeah.
You can't push a fork into dry ground, but when that same ground has got some moisture in it, you can push it.
Right.
It's a similar principle with this. Mm-hmm. So I think that just as you do with tractors generally, I mean, most tractors don't have downward pressure. Anyway, in terms of the frame, so you're saying a 4x4 frame, is that?
Yeah, 4x4 tubing, where we also have the added advantage of the holes.
4x4 tubing, yes, pardon me. Right.
Yeah, with the holes on 4-inch centers for the modularities that 1-inch bolts go into those.
Yeah. No, sorry, I thought you meant a 4-foot by 4-foot frame, so a square frame.
I see this as a universal kind of a frame that you can attach coulter wheels or whatever other things in front and back, etc.
Well, that's the that was, I think, Yeomans, I don't know which one it was, whether it was Alan or PA, had a saying that this is the only plow you'll ever need.
Mm-hmm.
And what they meant by that, I think, was that you would have, once you put this frame on the back of your tractor, you could put all of these other things onto it.
Yeah.
And therefore, you wouldn't need it. Now, that takes a fair bit of mucking around to make possible, but it can be possible, and mm-hmm. obviously the way we've played with things, it has been possible to an extent.
Mm-hmm.
But the type of frame that you need to do that, I think, is really important, and it's not a very long frame. It can be wide as you like, but not very long, because, as you know, the physics of putting things further and further out behind the tractor mean that the weight increases radically.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know the formula on that. You guys would probably have someone smart enough to tell you that, but or yourself, but. That's one of the reasons why I like that frame that we've used for years, is because it is so close to the tractor.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you start mounting other things onto it, it's not a big impact. Whereas if we had what I would call a twin beam frame, where the first lot of gear that you would mount onto the back of the frame would be almost double the distance from the back of the tractor.
Mm-hmm.
You need to go up a significant class in tractor to be able to manage that, and it also puts a lot of torsional stress through the linkage itself, and the pinions and whatnot. So there's a few of those things to bear in mind, mm-hmm. particularly if you're going to put weight on there, such as water mm-hmm. or fluids, which is obviously a I think a really natural thing to be doing.
Yeah.
You can hear our resident magpie.
Hmm.
This is just feeding the magpies.
Yeah.
It's called what Yeomans would call the 6SB frame, is a classic frame for that. I think it was originally designed so that it can have powered cultivators on behind it.
Powered cultivators?
Such as, I'll show you a photo. I'll bear with you for a moment. strong one. Let's get this up, this one. That frame there is one that we made in Vietnam in 2000, oh, here we go, in 2005, I think, yeah. And this is what I mean by a powered cultivator. This is, in this case, this is a just a little narrow rotary hoe. If you go to the next photo, you can see that same piece in action. And so with that, we were using that for ground preparation for tree planting. But the same setup could be used for for vegetable production or whatever else. But my preference for a powered cultivator would always be a power harrow, not a rotary hoe. They're just a much nicer machine on the soil.
Power harrow. Yeah, so, you'd favour power
one.
Harrow.
Well, spaders aren't bad, but they, you know, they're pretty expensive setups. Mm-hmm. So I'm a power harrow. This is a power harrow. Here, where's a good picture of it here? This is a power harrow. And you can see it's got instead of having rotating. knives, this one's got, well, it's got rotating knives. Instead of the rotary hoe where you've got an axle which is parallel with the ground surface rotating and sort of cutting the soil and in many soils creating a hard pan because of the sort of, if you run one hand over the top of another, like a, show you like,
the last one is a what?
Is a power harrow.
It's a power harrow.
Yeah. So if you look at my hand, from, I don't know if you can see me at all.
Yep.
So if you, so a rotary hoe is going like this on the soil, so it's coming through like that. So the dirt above there, it's all cultivating, but the dirt where it comes through in that knife, that laminar surface of that knife comes through, right where there's moisture or whatever, it glazes that surface as it comes through. And accordingly, once you're done with, and you know, and then it dries out or whatever else, then that becomes a glazed pan, which then makes it difficult for plant roots to penetrate.
Okay.
So they're very effective at surface cultivation, but they also have that phenomenon. Whereas the power harrow it runs perpendicular to the ground surface in terms of the rotation, and the knives don't have that sort of laminar surface contact underneath the ground. So they do a much nicer job. And you just don't get the pan. So that particular machine there, which is a is a Celli.
The green one, it says go on it.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that's a Celli, which is an Italian, one of the better Italian brand power harrows. They do a beautiful job, and they're perfectly married to that 2 meter wide yeoman's plow.
So basically, the harrow points.
Next photo,
okay, go ahead.
Go on.
I was going to ask, the harrow points move back and forth? Is that what happens there?
No, they rotate.
Okay.
So they, and they counter-rotate.
So it's so just the shape of the knives, right?
Yeah, so they go around like this. They spin like that and into each other. You got two knives and there's a gearbox along the top. Well, they've got gears on the top of them.
Mm-hmm.
And those gears are interlinked, which are then linked to the PDO box or the gearbox. And then that spins these knives this way. I haven't seen very many of them in the US, which is kind of surprising, but they're very common in horticulture here.
Mm-hmm.
And in Italy, and in Europe. They're very common in Europe, and mm-hmm. They're a really good machine. If you're going to have a cultivator, they do a very nice job.
There's a bunch of gears that come off the top, and each power harrow finger comes off a shaft off the top?
Correct, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So you've got these counter-rotate, so you've got these gears on top exactly, and they're
mm-hmm.
each of those are interlinked with the one next to it.
Yeah.
And so a single drive drives one, and then that drives all of them.
Mm-hmm.
But they run very smoothly. The gearboxes on them are super strong typically. They're a really good machine.
Mm-hmm.
We've always favoured them, but they're probably about another 30% more expensive than a rotary hoe or a rotary cultivator.
Mm-hmm.
But that, if you look at the next drawing, I think I've sent you or photo. Might be easier if I just share my screen, huh? And I can instead of going backwards and forwards, especially for if this is being viewed.
Yeah.
where are we? Present to everyone. So if I go back to
this is nice.
Here. Now this one here, this is the piece that is mounted on behind the frame.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just obviously a pretty simple bit of cutting. I think I might have another photo of, this is the double bearing block.
Mm-hmm.
That's mounted onto the top of the frame. So, so you can see here, I'll just get my little drawing number going here. And, you know, these are all of the bits that you have to pull together. So right here, you can see, here's the PDO shaft coming out of the tractor. And then right here is the double bearing block. So you've got a U-bolt here and a U-bolt here. And then you've got this plate of steel onto which are mounted two bearings.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got a spindle through the center of it, a shaft through the center, which has got two PDO shaft ends. And which you can see here. So that's what it looks like turned upside down.
Okay.
Right. And that's obviously an incredibly simple piece. And there, you know, you can buy these anywhere, these bearings. And you've just got to create a bit of shaft.
Sure.
Which is, you can buy as well.
Yep.
I don't know how far do you guys go with trying to buy things as opposed to not buy things? Because some things are just easier, I suppose, and universally available and just off the shelf.
Right. Things like anything machined like that, we buy bearings and shafts, but we do... Yeah. The new thing that we started doing is now we're getting into chain after we've discovered the bulldozer chain on the tracks. We're going to start making our own chain instead of buying like super heavy, like 100-weight chain. We're going to just make it ourselves because it's really robust and pretty easy to make. Yeah. Otherwise, hydraulics, I mean, we're all hydraulics, so we're going to probably have hoses running back there and dedicated hydraulic motors.
Yeah, yeah. if you can do, I mean, even with this sort of stuff, if you can get away with not having spinning mechanical things and use hydraulics, go for it, because it just makes it so much, well, it's less moving parts.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, generally the hydraulic pump, well, the hydraulic pump technology has got so much better in such a short amount of time that, you know, you should be able to run a whole lot on hydraulics now.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. The only thing about hydraulics, I suppose, as we go into the future, is that, you know, ultimately someone's going to be able to get a bit of steel and use a milling machine and make a shaft. Like, mm-hmm. you can make most that you can, if it's in steel, you can make it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yep.
But it's pretty hard to make hydraulic hoses.
Yeah.
Without
that's
some really specialized machinery. That's.
Mm-hmm.
So, but anyway, I think hydraulics will be with us for a long time. It's very effective and efficient.
Have you heard of like for alternative rubber sources like dandelion root resin?
No, that's not a toe I've sort of dipped into, that one.
Yeah, that's a commercially viable source that's been used in history. So we actually got some seeds of that for the Russian dandelion. So we do plan on going down into the materials later on. So
yeah.
That's not, we don't have to worry about that now.
No. So that's this last piece. You can kind of see how these are mounted underneath here. The
There's your triangle.
There's these three holes. So, yeah. Again, there's a U-bolt, which may well be better visible on another drawing here. You can see it kind of better there. I'll just get rid of that. Ooh. Now I pressed the wrong button. Back to there. Okay. So if you zoom in, I think I can zoom in a bit more, can I? That was probably not a good idea. You can see there's that piece here.
Mm-hmm.
There's
yep.
this backing plate, and then there's a U-bolt which goes around the frame.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's a really cool setup. We've used that to mount little conical spreaders, all sorts of stuff that you can mount behind the plow, so that while you're plowing, you can get to work. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then on this case, this client had a seeder mounted onto this as well. So while he was, while you did your ripping, you powered cultivating, and your seeding all in one pass.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is another thing to consider in all of this. Put on the list of on the very very long list you've probably already got of things that would be a seeder.
Yeah. Universal Cedar is officially in a 50 set of 50 machines. Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Yeah, because that's a... They're bloody expensive. I mean, we had one on our... That, the same size as that. It was $3,200.
Mm. Yeah.
For what is basically some plate.
Yeah. No, that's ridiculous. Mm-hmm.
Well, I get it. I mean, people are trying to make a living and pay their rent and all the rest of it. But when you're at the end, like if you had, like it's more complicated than they often make them more complicated than they need to be, is the other point I'd make, I suppose.
Yeah.
All right. So they're sort of ancillaries. Oh, and you can see up here as well that there's an extra hole in the top, so you've got one linkage which goes to the tractor,
mm-hmm.
and then you've got another hole which goes here, so you can mount another 3-point hitch on the back.
Yeah. How do you, as far as the height of that, I mean, once the shanks go in, you have to measure it so that the power tool is at the right height?
Well, that's where you've got these three holes here.
Yeah.
So you can according to, so these holes here in that bottom linkage, if you want this to go up higher, then you put it in the highest hole. If you want it to go lower, you put it in the lower hole. I mean, one thing I've thought of with this particular piece is that if I wanted to make this shallower, then one of the things I would do, instead of having this go like that, I'd have it go like this.
Mm-hmm.
So that it had another couple of holes or two or three holes going up.
Yeah.
So I could mount this thing quite high. So if I wanted to, for example, just cut 3 inches deep or 2 inches deep, well, then I could do that. If I wanted to just, you know, do a really, like a nice little surface cultivation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Man, in the field, when this thing is used by itself without being attached here, it's actually the roller that adjusts the height. So you see these pins here? They all generate the increments of... So there's... You put a pin in there, and mm-hmm. the downward pressure of the machine going down, it gets resistance against the pin. So obviously, if you've got a pin right at the top hole, then that's when this thing will go the deepest. But if you've got it on the bottom hole, then that's when it'll go the shallowest. This is a, you know, it can't go any deeper than the roller.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. As far as the design of the shank itself, so
yep.
Are we ready for that yet? So you're showing...
Sure, go for it.
Okay, so showing a pretty much a bunch of stacking of pieces of equipment after the keyline plow. I'm noticing that it's like I always wonder about that in the United States. You don't see that ever. And what's to be said about that? Is it that in a huge, super huge scale, like people...
No, not at all. No, the reason, actually, the stacking of implements has really come from Europe.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very, like, for 20 years, 25 years, it's been pretty well common to mm-hmm. see European tractors have front 3-point linkage and front what do you call it?
Power takeoff
and front hydraulics. In some cases, you've got front, middle, and behind and rear. Like even some Jap tractors, the smaller horticultural Kubotas and that sort of thing, the 20 to 30 horsepower Kubotas,
mm-hmm.
they've got front hydraulics, middle hydraulics, rear hydraulics. Some of them have got PDO shafts in the middle,
mm-hmm.
so that you can operate, say, a mowing deck or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So there's those types of... And the reason for that, I think in Japan, it's because they're working on small acreages and they're trying to be as efficient as possible. So the tractor becomes a power plant, kind of like your concept.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, in Europe, it's because of fuel costs. Fuel costs in Europe have always been much higher than they are in the US and here in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And so you'll never see a tractor in the US with front 3-point linkage unless it was an imported European tractor. I mean, one of my favorite tractors is the Mercedes-Benz MB track. This is on the back of now this particular machine that I was showing you. I think I do have some pictures of the MB track. Here it is. I mean, I don't know of a better design of a tractor. I mean, if I had my own chance, I'd probably do a better version of it, but it's a... I'll just get that screen back on. So this is the MV track. So it's a different kind of layout to most tractors. Big thing, it looks more like a utility vehicle, like a pickup truck.
Mm-hmm.
both it's got an air pump and a hydraulic pump, so it runs both. So the brakes are air, the gearbox is air. It's got a it would have to be probably a 60-pound cylinder on it, and air compressor cylinder, or compressed air cylinder. And so it's even got a nipple, so if your tires ran flat, you could or you needed to take a tire off or something, you can just put your air hose into it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's got all of those attributes, which make it sort of a highly utile vehicle. It's even got two seats. That's why I'm picking up my daughter here from school. But you see here, see, it's got linkage on the front.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got this tray on the back. So on the back there, I never did it, but this is where you could put, like, instead of putting a tank on the plow itself, you put it, you know, if you put an IBC on the back here or something like that, and then you could run 2,000 or 3,000 litres, you know, and on the back, you know, 500 gallon or 600 gallons or something on the back, and then you'd put all of that weight on the axle as opposed to hanging out the back.
Yeah.
You could also put something like a platform on the front if you wanted to, and, you know, put stuff, more liquids here, so that you balance the tractor out. And then you, on with the plow frame on the back, of course, then you could put, you know, if I was doing this for, well, one of my original plans was, and this has got a linkage underneath as well, PDO shaft as well underneath, was to have a biochar, pelletized biochar at the front here, which I would then, that would be one place I'd carry that, and then here I'd have my liquids, and that would then run through with hoses through here, and I'd be injecting it into the ground, and then I'd have a seeder here, or I'd have a tree planter on behind here, and then with that you'd then have someone planting, so you'd have planting trees, injecting biochar, injecting liquids, doing the ripping or subsoiling, and then tree planting all in one pass.
Oh, nice.
Which is all possible with a design such as this.
Huh. Very nice. As far as...
Very nice tractor, yeah.
I don't understand the air. Is the air just utility air, like for filling tires?
No, the air is... it operates the brakes, so it's like truck brakes.
Okay.
And the gearbox, the actuation of the gear changes was all by air as well.
Okay.
And this thing had a road speed of about 50 kilometres an hour, so about 40 mile an hour, 45 mile an hour. So it's based on the same platform as the Unimog.
Okay.
Which is the famous Mercedes truck, which is used by militaries and all sorts of things. I mean, the Unimog in itself is an amazing vehicle. I mean, there's people, I saw some in Europe and in Ireland, which are basically the same as this, except they don't do 100 k's and don't do 40 mile an hour. They do 70 mile an hour, and they've got front and rear linkage. They've got a full tray on the back. They're just an amazing, you know, just that much more utile than just a normal tractor. But again, that innovation has been created in Europe, where fuel costs have pressured designers to come up with solutions which are a lot more useful.
As far as
you can do more than one thing at once with, you know.
Yeah. Is the MB Track 900 a common machine in Europe, or?
Yeah, they don't make MB Tracks anymore, but certainly, and they were very popular here. I won't say they're not as popular as a John Deere or Case or, you know, all of the other more common brands, but they're certainly out there and they last. You know, people have got like 50-year-old MB Tracks and they're still working beautifully. They're a very robust machine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're pretty simple. Yeah, yeah. So, anyway.
Is this all under your Picasa album? And if so, which?
So if you go,
because I'm looking at it.
To just Picasa.
Yep.
Doherty.
Yeah, I'm on that page. You've got a number of.
Yeah, there's a whole lot of course. Things. There's a catalog there that's called MV track. So when you just go to the album, it's a fair way down, but it's there. Sorry, it's the only way. I don't know that there's a better way of cataloging it in Picasa.
Is that by MV track? Yeah, I see it. Okay.
It's by date.
Yep. Okay. By date. I see it. Yep. So it's MB track. What else on those rotary machines? Which album would be good for those? Some more of those.
I think the main one was Keyline. I don't know that I had specifically. I can send you some other diagrams or photos. But even if you just do a Google. Excuse me. Power.
Okay. Got it.
Power Harrow.
Okay.
These are pretty good diagrams of them, and you got YouTubes of them and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah. So have you run the operation of doing the biochar on the front and then compost
no,
the
no.
back?
It's like I said, I did a design of it, but I never actually did it. I think I've got one in here where I actually, if I just do Keyline Super Plow, I think it'd do. Here we go. Hope this will come up all right. There's all the diagrams.
Build fund, is that, did you try to?
Yeah, I tried to, we didn't end up needing it. We sort of built one anyway, but mm-hmm. I tried. I just thought I'd put a build fund out there to see if I could get some funds to build this thing. I don't know why that's not working on the photos, but I did a design in open. What's going on with this thing? I did a design of a concept plan of that whole thing years ago, and it was in here, but I don't think this is transferred over from my old website well. But anyway, I did this design and of the whole thing, and it was my plan to do it, but, you know, like a lot of plans, they just stay on the drawing board.
Mm-hmm.
But the new system that we've got now with the... with Jason Hagen at McIver Farm, which I think I've put a bit up on my Facebook about. I've got any other images here. No, I don't have anything specifically here, so, but on Facebook I've got it where I've got some images of
So basically, would you say that it is practical? So,
yep. So
biochar plus compost tea plus some of the other functions in one, is that practical, or this is like, you know, it's nice, but it's not really practical? What's your take on that? I mean, it seems like...
I think it's more just getting... I mean, if anybody was going to be able to do it, it'd be you guys, because mm-hmm. you've already got the shop. I mean, for me, I don't have a shop, so mm-hmm. if I had a shop, I'd be into it all the time, but I don't.
I mean, it's...
So it's certainly, you know, that, you know, if you live in town and you don't have a shop, it's a bit of a pain. So my mate has a shop, and so he gets into it, and that's why he's been able to make this particular machine here, where we've got Yeoman's new sticky leg shanks, which they've made, which are a pretty nice design, and been able to mount these on, and then we can do our seeding on behind that, as you can see here. So we've mounted a seeder on there, so we're ripping in front, and then we're seeding behind.
Mm-hmm.
So
those are just for seeders, like the those
yeah.
ribbed.
Oh no, you can. That's they're called a sticky leg. So Alan designed them so that you could put. He calls them a sticky leg because you can stick anything to them.
Uh-huh.
So you can put, you know, if you want to put a sweep on there or anything, you can put a sweep or whatever. There's all sorts of, like, little weed knives if you're doing horticultural work. You mount these on and then and they slide up and down. So there's a little worm drive, which is not really visible there. There's a worm drive in there that you just undo that bolt there or loosen that bolt after you take out this wedge.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can adjust the whole thing up and down.
Mm-hmm.
Through worm drive. It's a really great design. It's very clever.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, yeah. So going back to the shank design itself.
Okay. So basic design. Maybe go to page 9 on the Keyline Plow concept. So...
Yeah.
I mean, what I do, I mean, we want to do it from scratch, so like 1x6, like say 1x6 steel shanks or something like that.
1x6, yeah. Well, I suppose the big thing with all of the subsoilers that are out there, most of them are cast, they're not plate steel.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's not to say that you can't do it. For example, I was in Spain a few years ago, and I went to a small workshop in a very small village, and a guy was making subsoilers there, and he was just making them out of plate steel, and that was fine. I think obviously using plate steel is going to be a lot easier for a lot of people because they don't have to do the casting.
Is there an advantage to the cast?
Well, the casting, it just means that you can get a better metallurgy. You can basically they're making a tool steel, which has a lot greater modulus of rupture than does rolled steel.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, where you just you don't have as much choice in the metal compound. So, it's a lot easier to just get plate steel than it is. than to get cast.
Yeah. Okay, so we've got our shank. So what's the depth we want to go to?
Well, I think that generally the depth of the shank is related to not to the depth that you need to plow. As much as the underframe clearance that you need to have. So I know, for example, the Yeoman's people, for example, they don't recommend that you really subsoil any deeper than about 15 or 16 inches.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the reason for that is because once you get to that depth, typically the soils are of a structure below that point where plant roots will be able to do the job. And so if you've got I think they have a shank that's 31 inches, for example. Well, that's not so you can rip 31 inches. It's so that you can get the underframe clearance, because typically, like, that's being used in sugarcane and those sorts of plants or vegetables where you want to rip in between the rows, but you don't want to damage the plants while you're doing so. So if you went into a corn crop and you were doing intra row weeding or something like that, get some weed knives on, or you were doing even some subsoiling to get a bit more moisture into the ground, or sugarcane. Well, at the stage at which you would do that is when those crops would be, say, 12 to 18 inches high.
Mm-hmm.
So if you went in there with a 22-inch or 24-inch shank,
I see.
Then there's a fair chance that the frame of the plow would actually damage the leaves of those plants as it passes over. So that's the main reason why you have the depth. But if you're just doing if you're doing pasture as well, if as your pasture, you mean obviously as your soils get deeper and your root systems get bigger, then your foliage on top gets bigger. You get more of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so having a, so I think, you know, the sort of 24 to 26 inch sort of depth is what I would call a Mickey Mouse one. It's well, Goldilocks sort of depth. It's a good all round sort of depth or length of shack.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, obviously, there's a lot of stress that goes through these things, and I think that's where, and there's a couple of options. The most expensive option is to go down the pathway of having a hydraulic shank.
That lifts and, hydraulic.
Yeah, hydraulic shanks look like
that lift to the correct angle, or
no,
they bounce
no,
out of the way.
No. instead of having a shear pin.
Oh yeah, okay. Bounce out of the way.
Well, they lever up out of the way.
They lever passively by hitting a rock or something?
Yeah, exactly. So you've got a hydraulic, an accumulator.
Okay.
And then you, I'll just put it on this thing here. You've got a hydraulic accumulator. So that's filled with an amount of pressure. And then you've got hoses which go to the respective shanks, each of which has a ram on it. And so when it hits a particular amount of pressure, then instead of you breaking a shear pin or a shear bolt or something like that, the shank actually lifts out of the ground and then it comes back in again.
Yep.
So that's
how important is that feature?
It's important if you're trying to have a lot of utility, like. I'd say that, like, if I was a contractor,
mm-hmm.
which I have been, I've done thousands of hectares of yeoman's plough contracting or Keyline plough contracting. I would, and I was starting out from scratch, and I had the cash. I'd definitely buy a hydraulic shank because it'd mean you can just go into any paddock and not get out of the tractor. Whereas in some places I've been where I've broken so many shear pins, like I've spent most of my time replacing shear pins, not in the tractor dragging the machine. And when you're doing it for a job, then that's a real pain in the ass. Now, I'm not saying that, well, one of the things I'd go back on that, I'd say, well, perhaps you need to revisit where you use these machines. If you've got ground where you've got lots of rocks or boulders or whatever else that's breaking shear pins, well, then perhaps you need to apply a different kind of management to it. One of the things that I see in this space is that if I was going to do a sort of more open source machine, then it would be difficult without doing casting to have a shear pin system that'd work efficiently, that's what Alan Yeoman's oyster plate design is a fantastic design for that very reason, but it's cast, and to sort of, you know, make a version of that, I know it is, I think it's out of patent now, but even so, to make a version of that would be fairly difficult because it is cast. Mm-hmm. But if you're just going to use bolts, then the way that people get around that, such as they do with bulldozers, is they just go heavier.
Mm-hmm.
But even then, bulldozer shanks are all cast. They're not plate steel.
They go heavier so that they stall the tractor instead of...
Yes. Now, the whole reason why Alan and others, yeomans, put shear pins on is to protect the gearbox of the tractor, basically.
Well, I think we're actually already protected by that from the hydraulic pressure bypass. So we already
exactly.
have that in.
So if you've got a hydraulic bypass, then you don't have to worry about that.
Oh.
So therefore, in your, I mean, where I'm getting to is the to break or not to break, right?
Mm-hmm.
Something's going to have to break, and the usual ways that people cause things to not break is they usually go really heavy, or they change the metallurgy, or they have something that breaks, or you know. Or mm-hmm. the braking strain is much higher. And that's what I'm curious about in this process is how high, you know, how much strength are you able to put through a plate, you know, a plate steel and bolt-based system
mm-hmm.
Versus a cast-based system.
Mm. Well, my initial opinion on that would be is metal bends like butter under high stress, so I think this is going to pretty much bend out of the way. The tractor is going to stall and bypass the hydraulics, and it'll be fine. And you just keep going.
Well, the metal will bend?
Well, flex. So say you've got the 4x4 tubing in the back.
Yeah.
It's flexible. I mean, whatever the connecting pieces there are, I mean, the steel is pretty giving as opposed to breaking.
Well, yeah, to an extent. I mean, I know on most of these subsoilers, that square tube is half inch thick, wall
uh-huh.
thickness.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't have a lot of give.
Yeah.
I've made my own little frames just for doing specific jobs, and I've used quarter inch wall thickness, and it's the bit that gives, and
mm-hmm.
I've never broke it, but I've deformed it significantly.
Yeah.
Like, I've actually been able to put that much stress through that frame, through that tube, square tubing, that I've been able to put, you know, like 2 inch, I've been able to deform it by 1 to 2 inches.
Can it be designed such that when you hit a rock, the Keyline Plow does more of the jumping out of the ground as a whole unit?
I don't really think so, unless you spring it, which is the other way that people have done it. But if you want it, like Agro Plow, for example, they were making a shank, I think they still do, Agro Plow. Which again is another option. Where's the Agro Plow? So the Agro Plow was designed by, it's worth having a look at.
Mm-hmm.
The Agro Plow was designed by P.A. Yeoman's nephew, John Ryan. And John Ryan, he and P.A. Yeoman's won the award, the Prince Philip Award for the original Yeoman's Plow. As I understand it, John Ryan designed the point of the original, the wombat point of the original Yeoman's Plow. But if you do a Google image search for Agro Plow, and I'll send you the link there, just as a bit of inspiration. Yeah, actually, you've got it there. Put it. It's Agro, so G-R-O-W. Yeah, that's it. Now, I'll just see if I've got a sprung tine, because he did both rigid tines and sprung tines and a lot of other stuff. Yeah, pretty good. He's a pretty good designer, but it's worth having a look at his shear pin design, because it's pretty simple. It's a lot simpler in some ways than Alan's system.
Mm-hmm.
And like Alan's design of the shank, ultimately, it's also got a track on it so that you can mount other things onto it. In their case, again, it's a cast shank, but it's got cast holes, whereas the back of the Yeoman's shank has got actually a track, so you can wedge, so it all comes with a sort of a wedge system for mounting things in there. I'll just see if I can find a sprung.
Okay, so here, let me show you this one, because I'm not seeing it. So, for example, this length, I just... Oh, hold on. So where's the spring on that length I just gave you? It says Agro Plow.
Here we are. Sorry, I just had to find one. I couldn't find one. But they're not that common. But I had a client who bought one years ago, and that's a small, and that's the best I've got. I don't know if that links to Wikipedia. Oh, there's a better one. Shit, just as I bloody find it.
What's the speed of Keyline plowing?
In kilometers,
yep.
4 to 5 kilometers an hour. Yeah, that's a better one. So it shows a bit better. Sorry, I don't have a really good close-up of the agro plow sprung system, but it's a kind of a... it's just kind of a hybrid in the sense that it's got the sort of ripper shape, but if the going gets really, if the going gets tough,
okay,
then it'll spring up out of the way. So it's another option.
I see.
But I suppose where you're ultimately getting to is... or where I would think you might want to go is that you've got a frame, like it's the frame that's important, and then what hangs off that is where you get all the flexibility. Kind of like your idea with your, you've got a standard power plant, and that power plant is like a USB. You can plug it in anything, and except the power is coming from the USB, not from the device, if you like. And so I look at at your frame as being the thing that a whole range of different implements or attachments would mount onto.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of you taking off, having 10 million bloody implements,
mm-hmm.
you've got one frame onto which a lot mm-hmm. of different hot swappable attachments go on. And that's another part of this is, like, how do you design something that is really easy to take on and take off if you were going to do that, And that's another interesting thing to me.
So actually, I think we're going to nail that. So actually right now, because we're going to make the bulldozer reconfigurable from one unit to three units, you can literally take off from an 8,000-pound machine to 16 to 24. There's one artifact that has to happen, which is how do you attach shafts? Because the standard way is keyways. And I think I was looking into this. I was looking into set screws and clamp collars. And I think what we can simply do is clamp collars that you don't have to work the shaft for a keyway. You have all the power through large bolts on the large clamping bolts, which could apply to round tube and square tube. So for square tube, it's like you mount your implements on your 4x4s. For your rounds, like when you have the drive rotor, you can clamp on the sprocket. You can clamp anything else if you want to have a universal rotor. So we're going to probably have to do that. And I haven't seen really anybody go without keyways, but we'll try that. Because a simple large bolt, like a 1-inch bolt, that has over 10,000 pounds of, it's like 10, 20, 30,000 pounds of clamping force. So we're going to try that, but we have to do that so that we get to the required modularity and interchangeability.
Yeah.
So that's an interesting experiment. We're testing that out right now. So I was
kind of
racking my brain on that last couple of days, actually.
Sure. But I suppose you see where I'm getting.
Yeah,
absolutely. I mean,
yeah.
That's why I liked, like Alan's design with the, the coxcomb and wedge system.
Mm-hmm.
Is one of those systems, and then you can mount all sorts of things onto it. And I wonder. And that it's kind of like I look at the yeoman's shank and I look at the sticky leg and I think, gee, if you could make a kind of a hybrid between the two, that would be really awesome, because you've got this high degree of modularity between the two. It may be like the big advantage of the sticky leg is that you can.
When you say sticky leg, do you mean coxcomb and wedge?
No. It's the coxcomb. The sticky leg is that.
The one you showed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's this piece here. I'll just tag you in the photo on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
If you go to that thread that I've just tagged you in, there's a whole thread.
Okay.
Through those photos, you'll see.
Yep.
Anyway, the good thing about that coxcomb is that the sticky leg is that you can go up and down inside of it incrementally. Now, the coxcomb is another piece altogether. I'll just see if I can find it.
Did you tag me in another one, or?
Yeah, I'm just doing it now. I just had to find it. There we are. So this diagram here is where we made a small pipe layer in Vietnam. So we made a frame over there, and then I imported a couple of shanks, to do some ripping for our project over there. But I also imported is the little coxcomb and wedge. And so the coxcomb, as you can see, that's the red bit, and then it's got a little wedge.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes into, there's a track that's molded in, that's molded into the back of the yeoman's shank, so that you can put all of these other tools on the back of it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, that kind of design I really like for a whole lot of reasons. I mean, again, you've got that modularity. You can put, you know, I made that pipe layer
mm-hmm.
because I needed it. But I couldn't have done this unless I had the coxcomb and wedge.
Yeah.
It would have been a pain in the ass. So I would have had to weld something or cut something or do something silly like that. Whereas in this case, I haven't had to do that. So we did the same thing with with this piece here, which is the which was a bigger pipe layer, which again I'll put through to you. We made this in a shop in Vietnam, and and that worked.
Yeah,
that worked really well. So we made that out of a truck differential shaft. It's actually
the pipe.
The pipe.
Okay.
Yeah, so we just we cut it with a cut off saw. On the bends, because we didn't have a pipe bender, so we cut pieces out, then bent it, just bent it with a piece of steel, and then, but I think you'd appreciate this. And then what we did was we used a, see if you can recognize what this thing is. This was our flaring tool.
For the inlet?
Yeah. You guess what the what that thing is that's going into the top?
Oh, bombshell. No way, yeah.
Wow. So it's a gift of the American people.
Wow.
They have a lot of, my mate, you'd love this bloke, just as an aside, Tan, his name is, he's got a workshop. We were doing, he did a lot of fabrication for us when we were there, and he was having a big laugh because he had a whole shed filled with these unexploded ordnances.
Oh, wow.
Which had the detonators taken out of them. And so, but the metallurgy is fantastic. So he makes he turns them up and mills them and makes all sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
In this case, we were, sort of sounded, looked counterintuitive to putting a hammer to a bomb.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, indeed. So. Yeah, you'd love a lot of those. I don't know if you've travelled over those sorts of parts, but some of the stuff that those sort of guys make in their workshops, it's fantastic. I grew up in, my grandfather was a fitter and turner and a farmer as well, and my stepfather was a fitter and turner. And so I grew up with lathes and welders, and my late father was a boilermaker.
Yeah.
So I grew up with all of this sort of stuff going on. So... yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
But I don't have a shed, so I can't do it myself. I've got a lathe sitting at my stepfather's place waiting for a shed one day, and I've got a milling machine sitting there waiting to go, but I don't have a shed, so.
Yeah. So with the positive results of our biochar, running the power cubes on biochar, that was good. It makes me think of a combining tractor pelletizer continuous pelletized char maker that once you get in your tractor you never have to refuel. Do you think that's feasible? So be a little sideline operation going on there.
Throw that one out. That's a bit of a left field question.
I think that's doable. I mean, the pelletizer's in our system, and
you've got to keep feeding the beast, haven't you?
Yeah,
that's it. So, I mean, the practicality, sometimes you do want to actually stop,
have
a break, and so that might be the time when you do your refueling, or you do a hot swap, you know, I like that sort of idea of being able to hot swap things, definitely. Have you seen Mike Kellercrate's setup? Mike has got, Mike's doing bone char, but it's the actual machine that he's using to do the char, which is interesting. It's quite quick. Mike Kellercrate. And, what is it? Bone char. is. This is this Exeter biochar retort. It seems I like it because it seems a lot simpler and a lot faster than the usual charring setups. And it also seems fairly amenable to the addition of another jacket in which you can do things like have a heat exchanger.
Mm-hmm.
That you could capture, you could create hot water off it. But yeah, I mean, there's all of that sort of play that's nice and fun. But yeah, I don't see any reason why that wouldn't be possible.
Yeah, yeah. Where's this guy? Is he States?
He's in Kansas.
St. Francis, Kansas.
St. Francis, Kansas. Yeah, he's one of my clients.
So
I think he made one of these. Well, his son is an engineer. These guys are also... the reason why Mike's doing it, Mike is probably the leader in the world in mobile livestock slaughtering facility design and construction.
Oh, so this is the application for this, to char it up on a road?
Yeah, so what he's got a 6,000-acre ranch in western Kansas, and then he's got a retail outlet in, and then he's got an on-site slaughtering facility in which he slaughters his cattle and pigs, and then they go straight into a chiller and go straight to his retail outlet, which is in Colorado Springs in Colorado, so it's about an hour out of Denver, which is about 3 hours away from his farm. And at the retail outlet, he's also got a dry storage room, so mm-hmm. he dry stores the carcasses there, or dry ages the carcasses, and then he's got a boning room there as well, a packing room, so he does all of his own boning and packing. And part of my consultancy with him, I said to him, well, look, you know, what are you doing with all the bones? You should be returning the phosphorus back to your land. And I showed him this particular technique I learned in Mexico, and then he hooked up with a guy who did an even better job by doing it with the charring apparatus. So he got this Exeter retort and puts bones in there. And he got Logan Labs to do